Hi, my name is Les Gelb. I'm president of the Council on Foreign Relations, and Homeland Security is a passion with me and a passion with the Council on Foreign Relations. The purpose of this video is to help you get ready to think about what you need to do to pay attention for the emergencies that might occur in the event of a terrorist attack. You've heard a lot about all this recently from Homeland Security Secretary Tom Ridge, and you ought to pay attention to that. What we're trying to do in this video is to tell you what we do here at the Council to prepare ourselves and the people we work with, and to help them prepare for their family and loved ones. I hope this will be helpful.
Most of the things that I think institutions and individuals should be doing are things that make good sense to do even if we didn't have a terrorist attack. They have dual benefits. If we have a blizzard, if we have a tornado or a hurricane or other major natural disaster or man-made disaster, increasingly in this just-in-time life we live, where we wait for the last minute to go to an ATM machine or the last minute to fill up our gas tanks, and we expect communications to be at our fingertips, the facts are that occasionally those things are going to be disrupted for potentially a period of days. The kinds of attacks we're going to have are likely to be targeted at civilians and the critical infrastructure that underpins our economy, because the goal is to create mass disruption. The kinds of weapons to be used were probably the highest probability is the kinds of high explosives like we saw in the Oklahoma City bombing. Then chemical and biological are also increasingly readily available, and so an adversary may have their hands on those as well. Less probabilistic, but obviously more frightening, is the use of a dirty bomb, taking atomic energy components and then mixing into an explosive and spreading it, or the ultimate nightmare, which is an atomic weapon itself detonating somewhere in the United States. What we have to realize is the terrorists that we will confront are not supermen. Their attacks will be horrific for those who are in the immediate vicinity of those attacks, but they won't have broad sweeping impact likely beyond potentially a few city blocks or taking out a critical node in infrastructure. This will be profoundly disruptive for anybody who is in that area. And so the key in thinking about what do we do to cope with this amorphous threat is largely about being able to ride out the disruption that will come from these events. If you're in the crosshairs of the actual attack itself, there's probably not much that can be done to protect yourself. But again, these are likely to be localized kinds of incidences, though they could have a real ripple effects, like bringing down our financial sector for a while, shutting down ATM machines, closing down highways and bridges, and being able to cope and not be a part of the problem that is part of the chaos that comes out of these events is, I think, the biggest reason why institutions and individuals should take some precautions to be able to deal with these threats, to be able to ride out the disruption so they're not contributing to the pressure on the first responders that may already be overwhelmed coping with the immediate victims of these events. I think one of the most important things that's likely to happen if you're not in the immediate vicinity of an attack is to suddenly get worried about loved ones and, geez, and want to reach out to them. If the communication systems are down, then it tends to maybe to run off to your car and try to get there. The transportation systems, particularly in an urban area, are likely to be very disrupted. The best thing that people can do really is to stay put, and that's why institutions should also work to make sure that there's the ability for them to stay put, and both in terms of basic needs, but also communications needs, backup radios or other kinds of things, so folks can get informed, so again, you're not contributing to the chaos.
What we've done here at the Council is build on our existing safety and security procedures. All of our staff has been instructed on what to do in the event of an emergency, from how to report one to evacuating the building safely, where we would meet outside, instructions on when it is time to return into the building. We have a management plan in place which basically puts all of the key departments together to plan not only for emergencies but also how to react if a particular emergency occurs. We all have individual roles. Even though we're acting as a group, each department has a specific duty that they fulfill as part of the larger plan. There are some general building safety and security procedures that you should ensure are operational. Your fire suppression and detection systems, it's very important to make sure that they're online and operational. Fire extinguishers, it's very, very important that the fire extinguishers have a full charge and that they're checked regularly. your HVAC systems, it's very important that all your maintenance personnel understand and know how to shut these systems down if necessary. And we would want to shut systems down if we're instructed or advised to shut them down. We basically want to limit the amount of outside air that we're taking in. The filtration system, the filtration media that you have inside of your HVAC systems is also very important. You should be using HEPA type filters. HEPA filters are high efficiency particulate air filters, and what they do is basically block minute, minuscule, microscopic particulates from entering into your fresh air intake system. It's important that you check all of your emergency lighting systems to make sure that the batteries in the systems are fully charged and that any automatic transfer switches that you may have that basically put them over to battery operation if you have electrical failure are working and working properly. These things need to be tested. It's very, very crucial. We also have mailroom security procedures in place, and what we're doing is using the guidelines set up by the Postal Service for detecting or recognizing suspicious mailing packages. In the event of an emergency, it's very important that your response personnel, your emergency evacuation team, your emergency personnel team, can communicate with one another. We accomplish that here at the Council by using battery-operated two-way radios. It allows us to talk to each other prior to, during, and after an event. We've been instructed, if disaster strikes, to basically shelter in place unless we're instructed otherwise. And we need to be prepared to shelter in place. And we're also realizing that it's not just our own staff that we need to be concerned with. We also need to take into consideration any guests that we may have. The type of organization that we have, we hold a lot of meetings and large functions where the amount of folks that are actually in our building could be three times the size of our staff. So we need to be just as prepared to take care of our guests as our staff. The gas mask and dust mask, when it was first announced, the guidelines weren't very clear. As time developed, we were given the information, I should say, that what we're trying to do is not prevent ourselves from inhaling gases. It's impossible to prepare for that. You just don't know what sort of agent would be used, and the filters that you use are key to keeping them out of your system. What's been recommended is an N95 dust mask. They generally have a little metal nose bridge that allows you to clamp it over your nose for a snug, secure fit. And they generally have two bands that go at the bottom and above your ears. And the idea is that you want to keep particulates out of your respiratory system. And these particulates are not necessarily biological agents. If there is a disaster and a building collapses, that's going to create a lot of dust. And it's going to help you survive. It's going to help you breathe. It's going to make getting to your relocation site or any general mobility a lot easier. What we've done basically is prepare an emergency kit for staff and guests. And the emergency kit mirrors what somebody should have for themselves and their families. The kits include water. It includes food, non-perishable type food. It includes flashlights. It includes whistles. It really mirrors the plan that one should have for their family. We've also assembled to-go kits, the same sort of kits that folks should have readily available if they're asked to leave. If you need to evacuate your home or if you're asked to shelter in place, it's important to have a disaster supply kit. This kit should last you 3 days and should have enough items in it that are not going to require special preparation, electricity, and I'm going to talk about what's in that list in a moment. But it's also important to remember that you're preparing this kit not just to deal with an actual disaster. There could be lots of disruptions. ATM systems can go down, telephone systems can go down, power systems can go down, and we need to be as prepared as possible so that we can stay informed. I'd like to talk about a few of those items now. A battery-powered radio with backup batteries or battery-powered television with backup batteries will help you stay in communication and get official word on what you should be doing. A flashlight with backup batteries. Special need items such as medicines, eyeglasses, contact lenses. A first aid kit, and it's very important that you check the contents of the first aid kit to, number one, make sure that everything's in there, and also check the expiration dates. You don't want to have medicines that have expired and are no longer any good. a change of clothing, and your change of clothing should also include wet weather gear and comfortable shoes. Food. It's important that you select food that is not going to require a lot of preparation, ideally no heat and no water that would be used in its preparation. And if you're going to store canned goods, make sure you have a can opener. You need the tools to be able to open up some of the food that you decide to have on hand. It should be non-perishable. Water. It's important that we have 1 gallon per person per day, and this water is going to be used not just for drinking but also for sanitation. A sleeping bag, a sleeping roll, or adequate blankets. You have to remember, this is not just if you're going to be sheltering in place, but if you're asked to relocate. Copies of important family documents. Now, it's important that you keep these documents in an airtight, waterproof bag. And if you can, scan them onto a disk, cash. It's important to remember that banking systems can go down and you may not be able to get to your cash, so make sure you have enough cash on hand. Sanitation supplies such as soap, toilet tissues, disinfectant. You should also have bleach on hand as well as a general disinfectant. A whistle, an extra set of car keys, and a full tank of gas. Make sure your cell phone is fully charged. And anything that you'd like to add to this list, anything that's going to improve your comfort, improve your safety. This is just a very basic list.
As Frank Alvarez mentioned in the list of things that people should be thinking about to have in their emergency kit at home, one of the items, of course, is an emergency cash reserve. And that's one of the things that people have to decide for themselves, exactly what amount they feel that they should keep on hand. But as we all know, banks can close and ATM machines cannot be functioning for any number of reasons. So we wanted to make sure that people would be thinking about this kind of need and what they should do to make sure they had something at home to take care of their needs for a few days, maybe even as much as a week or so, whatever they felt was best for them. If for any reason we had to evacuate the building and couldn't get back in with whatever a reasonable amount of time might be, we've prepared a small emergency cash fund, and our finance people would take that with them as they exited the building. And therefore, if somebody had to leave their wallet upstairs or didn't quite have enough cash on hand, we would be able to advance them enough cash so that they could get home, they could buy emergency groceries if they needed to, pick up prescription medication, something of that sort. We urged everybody to put together whatever cash reserve they think they need for their own personal and family needs, and to keep it at home in a safe place, and to take it from their own resources, their savings, or any other resource if they possibly can. But we know there are some people for whom that might be difficult. So we offered any staff member who needed it a cash advance against their salary up to the amount of their take-home pay for one regular pay period. And they, of course, have to repay it to the institution, but it's a way of enabling them to put this little cash reserve aside and have it available as if and when needed.
After September 11th, we knew that there were several issues that we had to deal with respect to communications. Communications were impeded for many people throughout the city, including us, particularly us on September 12th, where we lost many of our high-speed connections and also our telecommunications phone system. What we decided to do was to bank on our analog lines and use those as backups, kind of like what's in everyone's home, as an adjunct to our T1 lines. And those communications have worked well. What we did was to roll that up into a disaster recovery plan, and that plan called for us to identify these analog lines, take those lines, and predetermine where they would go in the event of an outage of our phone system. So now we have those preset to go to whoever's going to need them in terms of command and control to expedite any kind of repairs. In addition to that piece, we also realized that we didn't have a list at everybody's fingertips for emergency phone numbers, home telephone numbers for staff, and we didn't have vendor telephone numbers as well. And those are terrifically important when you're in a crisis situation. You want those at your fingertips in the places that you're going to need them. That's another thing that we did. And I suspect that's a lot of what folks should be doing at home with respect to their kids and to their family and their who it is that you're going to be contacting in the event of an emergency. You know, where is your rally point? Who are the two or three people you count on most in the event something would go wrong? So we did much the same thing here. only in more corporate terms.
In addition to having those vendor telephone numbers and emergency and staff telephone numbers available, we also decided that it would be nice to have those in a file and an electronic document that can be transferred to a Palm Pilot, which is very easy to do. And most people that have Palm Pilots know you can just put something in a memo pad, just cut and paste it. And that is also a big help, because no matter where you are, if you're not at your desk or you're not at that piece of paper, if you have your Palm Pilot with you, there you go. You have all the numbers you need right at your fingertips.
We also realized that we wanted to put up a website that would enable our staff to communicate with not only their families, but also be able to communicate with the staff interactively. And also see, determine whether the building operations were going on as normal. If something had happened, you know, what's the status with the building? Is it open? For something as benign as perhaps a snowstorm, a bad snowstorm. The interactive piece of the website is probably the most, I think that's going to give people the most peace of mind, because what it enables you to do, or enables anyone to do, is to leave a message privately or publicly for folks that they need to communicate with. Specifically, if you're stuck here at the council and you can't leave the premises for whatever reason, or you can't communicate for whatever reason, you can leave a message much like you would on a public bulletin board. And if the folks at home, at your home, have that way to get to that website, which most people do nowadays, they can take a look at those public and private messages. And it really does provide for peace of mind. It has really helped us.
I'm Les Gelb, back again with some concluding reminders. Our message here is don't get scared, get ready. We've tried to give you some practical ways of how to approach problems at the workplace and at home. You should also take a good look at the information on the websites and books and pamphlets we're about to provide you.